This is Couple Joe Midday Madness right here on Tide 100.9 and streaming on the Tide 100.9 app. Joe Gaither, Sepp Shirey, Seth Hopper, and Aiden Dollins all hanging out with you guys for the next hour or so. We want to give a big thanks to Martin and Xavier Houston for getting the day started with the Martin Houston Show. You can hear them weekdays 6 until 7. We had Wimp Sanderson on Inside the Locker Room from 7 to 9, and Gary Harris just wrapped up the Gary Harris Show. You can hear him weekdays from 9 till 11. I'll be with you till 12. We'll pass it off to Big Noon Sports with Matt Coulter, Lars Anderson, and Christian Miller. We'll have Ryan Fowler on the game at 2 p.m. And then we're going to jump back in and kick Ryan off the air at 3:30 because Hunter Johnson and myself will be back for Tide Hoops pregame show. So keep it locked in to Tide 100.9. We'll be live and local all day long. And download the Tide 100.9 app. It's the best way to keep up with all your Alabama Crimson Tide news. So I am actually live on location at the Galt House Hotel, which is about 100 yards, 200 yards away from the KFC Yum Center. So I am in position, ready to get rolling on really for to Alabama's Sweet 16 matchup tonight. And geez Louise, I'm so excited. The table is set. The hotel here is buzzing. I've run into a bunch of members of the band. I've run into our buddy Brady. I've seen some of the Alabama cheer and dance team. I've seen a couple of members of the media as well. Ran into them. But shoot, I got in at midnight, but it's already buzzing around here. But I want to invite you to jump into the show on the Derek Daniel State Farm Hotline at 205-342-9904. We appreciate Derek Daniel for sponsoring the program. You can get all your home, life, and auto insurance needs taken care of with Derek Daniel, and we appreciate him. You can give him a call at 205-758-3391. All right, and you can always find us on the Twitter machine at Tide109, at JoeGaither6. Guys, go around the room. Aiden.
What's up?
At Aiden underscore Dollins, right?
Yes. That's me.
At Seth. Seth R. Hopper, right? Yes, sir. And at Septimus44, right? Right.
At Septimus underscore
44. Oh, almost 3 for 3.
_44. All right, so there's your roll call for today. Everybody in here doing good. We're going to send us your comments, questions, queries, or complaints right there to the Twitter machine. All right, so my experience last night was great. We drove up to Louisville. But I experienced all the NCAA tournament games via the radio, exactly how you're listening to us right now. And we want to thank Westwood One for putting that on TuneIn app last night so I could listen to those games. I'm going to lean on the guys just a little bit because they actually saw them with their eyes. But I want to start with K-State and Michigan State. That was really the game that started off the evening, and what a game that it was. You had Noel setting an NCAA tournament record with 19 assists. And guys, just tell me about it. Your impressions of Noel and just controlling the game for Kansas State, because it sounded like every time that Kansas State needed a bucket or needed a play, that he was involved. Now, the radio guys did a good job painting the picture that he ended up getting hurt in the middle of the game and then came back, but they kind of couldn't decide how hurt he was. So, Seth Hopper, how hurt was this fella when he left with an ankle injury, and just your thoughts on his performance?
I mean, he was hurt, but like they said that he didn't want to go out. Like he wanted to come back in, so there was no way he was going to stay out of that game. But his performance last night was just amazing. The game overall was fantastic, but he was playing his heart out. He really wanted that win, and just 19 assists, which is a tournament record, I believe, is just, I mean, he was playing his heart out and really wanted that win.
All right, Seth, I think his microphone is not quite all the way on. He's going to be on guest one, I believe, probably. So, Aiden, your thoughts on the alley-oop at the very end of the game that really kind of sealed the deal. Noel to Keontae Johnson sealing the deal for Kansas State.
Just an absolutely wonderful moment. That was an intense game. That was all the basketball we could have asked for. I said on Ken's show on Wednesday, I said, in such a close game like this, I think you got to lean towards the Hall of Fame coach. And it's a miracle that Kansas State was able to overcome that, because that is still Tom Izzo on the other sideline. And just some of the things they did throughout that game, like the pass off the butt, just incredible. But no, that was spectacular what it came down to at the very end.
Yeah, and so you say that, and I agree with you. Tom Izzo, awesome coach, amazing coach. I had Kansas State making it this far in our bracket, really, because and I'm probably prisoner of the moment, but when Kansas State beat Kansas earlier in the year, I thought, wow, this team is actually really good. And the Kansas State coach, I know I was critical of him on Cup of Joe, Jerome Tang, getting up on the podium and really like celebrating that win, because I thought, oh man, you're really hyping up a regular season win. But Jerome Tang came from Baylor, recruited that Baylor team that ended up winning a national championship, and what he came to Kansas State, first year coach, and really hit the transfer portal hard. And Gus, he's got those guys believing. I think Coach Sanderson said it this morning that those guys are don't know that they're in the NCAA tournament. And Coach was being kind of facetious. He was really, really saying that those guys just kind of aren't really plugged into the magnitude of the moment. And that's not really a slight on them. I think he was really just trying to say how carefree they're playing. They're playing with house money at this point. I mean, if you're Kansas State, you're the little brother in the state of Kansas. You're not the Jayhawk program. So these guys know that at this point they've maximized, really. I think they've maximized their talent, and at this point they're playing with house money. So now Kansas State wins over Michigan State, and they will play FAU, because FAU beat Tennessee. I paid attention to that game a little bit. It sounded like the announcers were not wanting to call Tennessee dirty, but it sounded like Tennessee was up to their same old dirty tricks. They were talking about Rick Barnes complaining to officials about not getting calls or getting certain calls and late in the game that weren't being called early in the game. I think Tennessee just they just do that. They just kind of play that nasty style, that tough physical style. Rick Barnes is always going to have a team that is prepared, ready to play and prepared. And it sounded like they were prepared last night. Obviously, I didn't get to watch the game Sep Shirey, because I was on the road driving. So give me your thoughts, Sep Shirey, on Tennessee losing to Florida Atlantic.
I mean, it was an interesting game, and to your credit, yeah, Plavisic was just doing
elbows everywhere is what it sounded like.
Absolutely fouling everyone to death. You know, flagrants, like technicals, you know, a lot of people thought that he should have gotten ejected in the past two games that he played. So, but that's just how he's been playing all year. I mean, anyone who's watched Tennessee can attest to it. And depending on how well they do, it's really all about the whistle. If Tennessee gets called for their fouls, they're not a good basketball team. If they're able to get away with it, like they are a lot at home, then they win. And you saw that in the Duke game. They just dominated Duke physically and, you know, in the game of basketball. But yesterday, FAU just looked, you know, at first they were definitely falling victim to the Tennessee pressure and the defense. They looked a little bit out of their element, but they kept their composure, and eventually, I mean, I wasn't shocked at all when they turned it on, because I thought Tennessee's going to do this at some point. Why not FAU? And FAU just jumped ahead. Their offense, they finally started hitting some shots. Tennessee wasn't as effective, and just like that, they flipped the game and held the lead for the last few minutes.
Yeah, so they got hot toward in the second half, and they outscored the Vols 40-28 in the second half, and ended up really pulling away towards the end. Jusnell Davis and Nicholas Boyd leading the way for the Owls. And I wondered to myself, as that game's kind of taking place, UAB split with FAU this year. They split with FAU in the regular season, and I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, Seth Hopper looked this up, I believe UAB lost to FAU in the conference tournament. But regardless, I do know that that UAB split with the Owls, and we see UAB, who's in the semifinals of the NIT out there in Las Vegas, going to play, I think, on Monday or Tuesday of this coming up week. You see the Blazers, and obviously you've heard about Jelly Walker all year long and how talented he was, and we know the name Andy Kennedy just based on what he did in the SEC and his time on the SEC network, and he's very quality coach. And I wonder to myself, it was UAB really, really that close to being, you know, we know that what Conference USA is one big league, and that I kind of hate in and of itself, one big leagues, and kind of the preference that they give at larges to middling teams in Power Five conferences, like, you know. So I think would UAB have gone far? Would UAB have been able to be competitive in this year's tournament? And I think they would have been. Now I don't think they would have been in the Sweet 16 or even winning last night to get to the Elite Eight. But I take away from FAU's win at against Tennessee and really their run in the tournament, and I look through their schedule and I think, you know what, UAB really wasn't as far away. Yes, okay, so they played. Yeah, so they were 2-1 against UAB this year. They did beat them in the conference tournament, as I'm verifying that.
Yeah, 78-56 was the final score of FAU and UAB.
Yeah, exactly. So I wonder. I think UAB, you know, should be encouraged and should really feel good about themselves and feel good about their season, considering where they are in the NIT tournament and considering where their conference brethren has gone. Now, on the flip side of things, you look at the conference. Tennessee loses last night. Arkansas gets their doors blown out last night. And you look around, Aiden Dollins, and Alabama, we are the last ones left.
It's almost as if we swept the conference.
Yeah, so I'm really, our friend Jeff in Tennessee yesterday calls in and, oh, I hope they all lose, all three SEC teams lose. Well, Jeff, you got to, you got part of your wish. You got 66% of your wish has been granted. Tennessee is eliminated. Arkansas is eliminated. So now neither of those schools can look at you, Kentucky, and say, ha-ha, you know, we're better than you, I guess, is the Kentucky fan.
Sure they can. Kentucky got eliminated in the round of 32, right?
That brings up a question for really the class and for all of our callers. When you make it into the tournament, we had six teams make the tournament, and we had three teams, SEC teams, make the Sweet 16. And that was a lot. A lot of people thought that the SEC was down this year, but you still had three teams make the Sweet 16. I don't know that tournament success. I don't know that tournament success is indicative of conference strength or not. Look through the Sweet 16. You had how many Big 12 schools did you have? Texas, Kansas State, the rest of the schools in the Sweet 16. Texas, Kansas State. Okay, nobody else yesterday. Anybody else today? Houston is not a Big 12 school. Da, 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 da. That's it. So two from the Big 12 that was arguably the best conference in college basketball this year. You think about the Big 10, you look through, nobody's playing today. Yesterday, Michigan State won from the Big 10. Made it. In the Big 10, a lot of people saw as the second best league in the country this year. So you see three, you know, the Big 10 and the Big 12, the two best leagues in the country, by the pundits say, by the analysts say, only had three collective teams in the Sweet 16. I don't know that we should be raising the banner that the SEC is so strong just because we got three schools into the Sweet 16. I think once you get into the tournament, it is so dependent on matchups and so dependent on styles and the draw of the tournament that, you know, we got six schools into the tournament. And I think that is that's a great thing. That shows the conference's strength. Once you get the eight schools into the tournament, let's say Texas A&M ended up with Texas A&M was eliminated in the first round by Pittsburgh. But if they had played somebody that was not so good, or if they had played a more favorable matchup and made it further, would we have said, oh, Texas A&M, they were so strong, they were so good? No, we knew that Texas A&M was a good team. Not tested in non-conference play, you know, just not quite that upper top 10% like at the Alabamas of the world. I don't know. I just don't know, Aiden or Sepp or Seth, that teams getting into the Sweet 16 or teams getting into the Elite Eight is a great metric to say, look how strong their conference was.
Joe, the only way we can judge the strength of a conference relative to other conferences is via out-of-conference games, and the conference play games probably mean a little bit less than any of the mid-conference play challenges or even the NCAA tournament, because the teams are still finding their groove, they're finding their identity, they're getting going, they're gelling as a group. If you can't over, and we talk about matchups and style of play when we're referring to NCAA games and how seeding can affect things and things like that. If you as a team can't find a way to overcome stylistic and matchup issues in the game you're playing against another team, not from your conference or from your conference, then regardless of how many wins you had in your conference, you're not all that strong of a team. And if consistently across the board, teams in your conference cannot find a way to overcome those matchup issues, especially when the games matter the most, you're not that strong of a conference. So if in the sample size we have to look at, say the NCAA tournament, teams from your conference do not fare well against other conferences, then your conference isn't that strong.
Is it more, does it speak to the conference as a whole, or is it those individual matchups, those individual teams, those individual, you know?
When you have eight of the 14 teams from your conference, especially most of the top half, I think it speaks to your conference. When it's a consistent notion across the sample.
So maybe I was wrong this year, Aiden. Maybe I was wrong by saying the SEC wasn't that strong. Maybe I was wrong, say, you know, questioning Alabama's strength throughout the middle of the year when watching, you know, teams struggle throughout the season. Maybe the SEC was stronger than I originally was letting on, or originally was analyzing, was judging. Maybe it was stronger because, yes, even though Arkansas got blown out yesterday, and even though Tennessee lost yesterday, you did have three teams. The SEC had three. There was no other conference, no other league that had more than that. As I'm
scrolling, the Big 12 had three, right?
Big 12 only had two: Texas and Kansas State. Houston's not a
Big East.
Houston's not a Big East. Was Xavier?
Big East has
yes,
three, I think.
The A-10 have anyone? No.
No, Aiden. You know that.
I'm silly.
No. Aiden thinks everything's about Virginia. We don't care about
the Mid-Atlantic.
We don't think anything. We don't care about the Mid-Atlantic anything. No, the Big East has three. And Creighton. And Creighton. So is the Big East the strongest conference in the country? I mean,
it's potential.
By that metric, you might say yes, especially now that UConn has won. I think Xavier loses tonight, and I'm hoping that Creighton loses tonight. I think Creighton will win, but I'm hoping that they will get upset. I just don't know. To wrap this all up and send us to break, I just really think that, one, I don't really have a whole lot of interest or care about conference strength, but I don't think that winning in the NCAA tournament is indicative of how strong or how weak a conference is. We'll go ahead and hit our break right here. I know I've got Jeff in Tennessee. I'm sure he wants to disagree with me or talk about some of the NCAA tournament games last night. The Derek Daniels State Farm Hotline is still open for business at 205-342-9904. I'm broadcasting from the Galt House Hotel right next to the KFC Yum Center right here in Louisville as I'm getting ready for Alabama and San Diego State tonight. When we're done with our phone calls, we will talk about Gonzaga and UCLA. That was the game we left on the cutting room floor. We'll talk about that game, and then we'll just keep it rolling right here on Cup of Joe. This is Midday Madness on Tide 100.9.
Looking for a car that's as reliable and powerful?
From our home base right here in Birmingham, Alabama.
We are here treating patients from every generation.
Across the United States.
And from around the world.
As respected industry leaders.
We are here.
Working hard for you.
In an effort to provide you with.
Excellence in sports medicine.
Excellence in research and education.
And excellence in sports injury prevention.
We are here for you. Aggressively pursuing.
Victory over injury.
Learn more at andrewsportsmedicine.com.
100.9 Tuscaloosa weather.
Partially sunny, warm, and breezy this afternoon. The high today, 82. Windy tonight. Thunderstorms arrive after midnight. Those storms could be severe. Then tomorrow, rain ending early in the day. The sky becoming mostly sunny. The high at 83. I'm James Spann on the ABC 3340 Weather Center on Tide 100.9. It's 75 degrees in Tuscaloosa.
Every game and every moment right here. This is your home of Alabama sports. Tide 100.9 and streaming on the Tide 100.9 app.
Tide 100.9 app. Joe Gaither, Seb Shirey, Aiden Dollins, and Seth Hopper all hanging out with you guys for another 30, 40 minutes or so. Want to head out to the Derek Daniels State Farm Hotline and welcome in our friend Jeff in Tennessee. Jeff, what's going on, man? How we doing?
There we go.
Jeff, what's good?
How's it going? I just want to give you a little facts here. The SEC in the postseason, in basketball postseason, they're 11-9 in the postseason this season. All of it against the NCAA and the tournament you don't care about, the NIT. Okay? And the conference
I'm going to explain it to you. Go ahead.
Conference USA, it's 14-1 in the postseason.
Great.
Shoot. Okay?
They for Atlantic with Tennessee, and I loved every minute of it. And I loved that. I wish it had been 158-65. We didn't see Eric Musselman's chest deal last night, did we? We sure did.
I was very happy that.
We saw the hog jaw, and the hand was good for UConn, and I loved ESPN. That's every single minute. I loved it. And I love the fact Tennessee lost. It's regular season, Rick, again, and I'm going to love it. If Alabama loses tonight, I'm going to love it, too. They'll be all done.
So 14-1. Hold on. I'm doing this math in my head. I'm stuck on the math here. UAB is one of those. UAB, Florida.
UAB, Florida Atlantic.
And UAB won. North Texas won, but then ended up getting eliminated. So those are your three
North Texas,
teams.
They're both in still. UAB and North Texas in it, too. They're playing Wisconsin.
You're right.
And Rice and Charlotte were in the CBI.
Well, who cares about the CBI?
Well, it's a postseason tournament. I'm just telling you.
It's a postseason tournament that those teams.
I don't care. Those teams pay to be involved in. Well, that's fine. That's fine. It's like paying for your friends.
Hey, man, will you be my friend? Let's all pay so we can be friends together.
Well, whatever.
I'm following your rabbit hole. What's the point? Is the Conference USA better than the SEC?
Better than SEC. That's what I'm talking about. My point is, they're better than SEC. They've only got five teams in the postseason. And we got SEC's got 10. Texas A&M loses to Penn State. Why the basketball?
Texas A&M is average.
Michigan State loses to Pittsburgh in the first four. They should have been in the tournament to begin with.
They
shouldn't have been in to begin with. They're a bum team. They should be in the FBI. The Federal Bureau of Investigation. See if they ain't got a basketball team.
If they're a bum team, they belong in the CBI.
No, they belong in the SBI. We're going to see if I got a basketball team and start one. They ain't got one. That's the bottom line. You know it. Don't give me this crap. You know it.
Jeff, I don't even know what you're trying to say.
They're better than SEC, pal. That's what I'm telling you. They're better. They whipped Tennessee. Kentucky beat them twice. My alma mater beat UAB, Charlotte twice, beat Fort Atlantic when they were ranked. Beat Hofstra, who beat Rutgers in the NIT, and beat Montana State, who was in the NCAA tournament. How about Middle Tennessee going to the NCAA? We don't get no love. So hush. Have a good day. See if y'all beat San Diego State. But if y'all don't, I'm calling you Monday. Have a good day, pal.
Roll Tide, Jeff. That was a fun one.
I think Jeff's a little fired up.
It was honestly like one of the more coherent rants he's gone on.
I agree.
And, like, he got himself out. We didn't have to drop him. This is growth from Jeff, and I'm really happy to see it.
I got worried for a couple of moments, but I'm just confused.
I'm just confused.
Not even saying CUSA is better than the SEC. I mean, it's not the most outlandish thing he said on this show.
If that's the point, then all right. Great. Conference USA is better than the SEC. What does that matter? What does it matter? What's the point? What does it matter? And what's the, like, yeah, it's just, like, I don't understand the, okay, yeah, MTSU, you won a couple of games. Great job here in Murphy. They're in Murfreesboro. I drove through through Murfreesboro last night. Like, CUSA 14-1. I don't understand. Okay.
It's a pretty decent place to stop and get gas.
You know, I think if I just try to understand Jeff, then I'll drive myself into oblivion. Let's talk about Gonzaga. Let's talk about Gonzaga and UCLA. Let's talk about Drew Timmy. Goodness gracious, where would Gonzaga be without Drew Timmy? Seb Shirey. Drew Timmy last night, what, 30, 40 points? I'm trying to get to my box score.
36.
It seemed like every time. Yeah, 36, 13 rebounds. But You very, very close. 36 points, 13 rebounds, four assists, two blocks, four turnovers, and two fouls. He was 3 of 6 from the free throw line, and you were very, very close, Drew Timmy, from being from being the hero, from going from the hero to being the GOAT, which is absurd to me. Crazy to me that on 36 points, you know, if he had missed those free throws at the very end, which he did, and UCLA comes down the floor and scores to win the game, you know, all the yahoos on Twitter, all the internet crazies would be, "Ah, oh, Drew Timmy, you're not a clutch player. Can't be, you can't trust him. Can't do it." But my man scored 36 points, and Gonzaga would be would have been eliminated 3 rounds ago without Drew Timmy. Like, it's just nuts how people just how razor thin the margins are from being, you know, a hero, Drew Timmy, or to being GOAT. You could have been, you know, missed the free throws, you can't play. But his performance is still the same with those makes or misses. The performance is the exact same. It just is contingent on UCLA making a play at the end of the game, whether the narrative would have been in Drew Timmy's favor or not, which I think is hilarious. Like, his performance wasn't the same. His performance was the same, but it was really contingent on the UCLA factor. So Seth Hopper, Drew Timmy versus Jaime Jaquez last night, two epic performances from really two great teams.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. The game was great. I mean, we had two fantastic games last night, but Drew Timmy, even though he did miss those two free throws at the end and UCLA was able to get the lead, but Gonzaga ended up winning, he played fantastic last night. And the fact that UCLA was here with how many players they have out is just – it speaks to how good of the bench players they had and how much depth they had on their team. But that was a great game last night, and Drew Timmy – prove that he can, you know, he's really good. And so even though he did miss those two free throws last night, he played great the whole game.
He was so close to going out like Adam Morrison. He was dangerous.
Well, yes.
The history repeating itself.
Yeah, exactly, Seth. You've got Morrison, who loses, what, the 2011, 2010 Sweet 16 to UCLA. They were up on UCLA at that time, but UCLA came back in that game and made Adam Morrison cry. But Drew Timmy, they were up. It was almost deja vu, word for word, play by play. It was almost the exact same scene over again, Seth.
It was close. I mean, in that game, Gonzaga was leading the entire game and then squandered it all at the very end. Whereas in this one, UCLA first had to squander it to then give it over to Gonzaga to be in the driver's seat. But that was just, I mean, that was astonishing to watch, just the way that this game was just a game of runs. And UCLA then made another little run at the end. You know, they had the lead. It was a tremendous shot. I forget the Amari Bailey. That's the guy's name. Tremendous shot. But, you know, Julian Strother. Got to give credits, you know, as a certain commentator would say, Bill Raftery, big time onions.
Onions on that fella.
Big time onions for Julian Strother there at the end. And that's all she wrote. Tiger Campbell got a decent little look at it from half court, but Gonzaga moves on. Another classic.
So do we see the best two games in the tournament yesterday in K-State, Michigan State win, Gonzaga and UCLA?
I think Kansas State, Michigan State was the best game in the tournament so far. That's what I was saying after the game. I think that was the best game so far.
It was certainly a tremendous one. I mean, Marquise Noel put on a show for the ages. Personally, as good as Drew Timmy was, I think Marquise Noel had the performance of the day yesterday. I mean, you break a record in assists, sorry, that's going to do it. And lead your team to the win, obviously. But, I mean, both were
just with the extra injury factor. You got, with the extra added drama of the injury, the ankle, the foot, whatever he kind of nicked up as well. All right, so we'll go ahead and take a break right here. We'll come back and we'll do the last segment of Cup of Joe. We're live here in Louisville. I'm at the Galt House right next door to the KFC Yum Center. I want to tell you at 3:30, Hunter Johnson and myself will be back for Tide Hoops pregame show. We'll be leaving it off to Big Noon Sports here at 12 o'clock, and Ryan Fowler will come and do an abbreviated version of the game. We will be airing the ball game right here on Tide 100.9, but if you're looking for it on the streams tonight, I want to let you know you won't be able to find it because Westwood One owns the right rights to the digital streams. So on the app and online, you'll have to be looking for Westwood One. So you can find that on TuneIn or the Varsity app. We can find those feeds of the game online. When we come back, we're going to talk about all the games that are happening tonight. We'll talk about Lamar Jackson and this weird agent who's not an agent that might be negotiating with Lamar. And we've got much more on the other side. This is Cup of Joe, Midday Madness on Tide 100.9.
This is a Town Square Media Tide 100.9 Sports Update.
I'm Kim Rankin with your Tide Sports Update. Alabama football head coach Nick Saban clarified his wrong place, wrong time comments that he made on Monday. The Alabama men's basketball team arrived in Louisville, Kentucky for its Sweet 16 matchup against San Diego State. Nick Saban spoke highly of Will Anderson during Alabama's Pro Day.
This has been a Town Square Media Tide 100.9 Sports Update.
Play it again!
For more info on these stories and more, download the Tide 100.9 app. The flagship station for Alabama Crimson Tide sports. Tide 100.9 and streaming on the Tide 100.9 app.
The ball is ticked, and there you are. You're running for your life. Shooting star in all the years. No one knows just how hard you worked. But now it shows in one shining moment. It's all.
Joe, Midday Madness on Tide 100.9 is streaming on the Tide 100.9 app. One of the most underrated, one of the best moments at the end of every tournament, the one shining moment montage. And I'm hoping and praying and hoping and praying, Seth Hopper, that at the end of the montage, it's going to be our man Nato. It's cutting down the nets. And we get our next, the next step starts tonight at 5:30. The Alabama Crimson Tide takes on San Diego State. And I'm nervous. I'm very nervous. I'm very
nervous
concerned.
No,
it might just be that it's game day and it's finally upon me that I'm nervous. But oh my goodness, the San Diego State defense, number three defense against the 3-point shot in the country. Now, many people will hear that and think, oh my gosh, we're gonna lose tonight because we live and die by the three. But we do not live and die by the 3-point shot. We absolutely do not live and die by the 3-point shot. We live and die by Alabama's defensive effort.
Yeah,
so that's what's going to come down to tonight.
I mean, yeah, with Bediako and then you got Pringle coming in off the bench. I mean, we have a pretty solid defense too. So this is not just an offensive team. We have a pretty solid defense too. So I think this is going to be a close game tonight. But I am nervous with that San Diego State defense. But I think we'll be able to hold them off and win this game.
Yeah, I think we're going to be able to hold it off and win as well. But I am nervous. I'm concerned about playing a team that really has nothing to lose. Really get into your second Elite Eight ever. You're right on the edge of like, okay, here's the area where you've never been before. You get to the Elite Eight, and then you're right there playing for a Final Four. I mean, Coach Sanderson ended our show today by saying, "What I think when we talk on Monday, Alabama's going to be in the Final Four," and I just about fell out of my chair.
I hope he knocked on wood after saying that.
Yeah, well, you know, Coach, he's confident and Coach analyzes basketball very well, and so I trust him. Alabama's depth is so good. Like, we should win tonight. We should take care of business. I've been doing this whole thing for the last couple of weeks about just, you know, knowing with my eyes that the Alabama basketball team is very good, but kind of being apprehensive in my heart based on prior heartbreak and prior disappointments. We should take care of business tonight, and I think we absolutely will. But let's put that aside and talk about the other three games real quick. Sep, you've got Miami and Houston, Princeton and Creighton, Xavier and Texas. Once Alabama handles its business, I think we're going to have a great slate of basketball to enjoy, because I think Houston and Miami is going to be a great game. I actually like Miami to really challenge Houston in that game. I think I'm going to pick the Hurricanes to win. I think Creighton's going to win pretty handily tonight. The line has been moving. It's now up to 10 points. But I think Texas played Seuss very, very well, but I think Xavier and Texas is going to be a great game. I'm going to go with Miami, Creighton, and Texas as your winners in those three games. But I think after the Alabama matchup, once all of our nerves are subsided, we'll be able to sit back and enjoy some great basketball tonight.
Yeah, I absolutely agree with your picks also. I mean, I think Miami's going to give Houston a run for their money, absolutely. I think they'll at least cover the spread, if not win the game outright. But, yeah, I mean, Xavier and Texas, is a really interesting game, I think. Xavier's been almost, dare I say, overachieving. I mean, Sean Miller is their coach, fantastic coach, and it's well-documented what he can do with the program. But, you know, Sean Miller has this team in a good spot with, you know, a decent team, and they've got good players. But Texas, I don't see how Texas doesn't win this game, considering I think that the players at this point are playing for their coach's job. I think the players are playing for Rodney Terry, and I think they want to make a deep run in this tournament so that Texas decides to keep Rodney Terry on as their
coach. If they don't keep him, they're foolish. They're absolutely foolish.
Oh, absolutely.
Because the team's proven.
Absolutely, I agree that would be so foolish, but the word is, at least up until recently, that they've been looking other places, that
right.
Terry was
and
never
the team,
their long-term solution.
It's crazy because the team has proven and shown over the last, what, 3-4 months that they're playing for the guy, that he knows what he's doing. The results are still there. Now, I don't know empirically how he recruits, but I'm going to assume that he played a heavy part in recruiting the roster that's already there. He's familiar with Texas. I don't know why you wouldn't just keep him.
What more can you want? I mean, true.
You held on to a good season. You salvaged what was really a – think about it. You get a team that's probably in the running for a number one seed, and you fire the coach over scandal. What usually happens right there, Seth? What usually happens is the team falls apart and everybody hates each other and people quit and people transfer out, X, Y, Z, A, B, C is gone, and everything falls apart. But this coach held everybody together. He said, you know what, we're going to figure it out. We're going to stay together. And the results have stayed very consistently good.
I mean, yeah, I mean, like you said, they would fall apart, but the fact that they made it this far with that scandal and everything going on, it speaks to how well the coach was able to get this team together and say, let's go win this. Don't focus on anything outside of this tournament and let's go win this. So I don't understand why they would, you know, get rid of them, especially making it this far with everything going on.
All right, Seth. Let's go out to the Derry Daniels State Farm Hotline and go. I'm actually in the east side of the hotel, the east side of the Galt Hotel. Let's head out to the west tower of the Galt Hotel and find my friend Brady. Brady is in Louisville. He's been playing his tail off. Brady, you got any energy tonight to bring the Tide through to the Sweet 16? Brady. There we go. Yep.
Man, I'm on a delay.
I don't think you were on at the current moment. What's going on?
Okay. What's up, Doc? How y'all doing?
Good, man. Good. Tell everybody what you've been up to in Louisville as you've been getting ready to play tonight.
Man, been to some good restaurants. Went to Guy Fieri's Smokehouse first night up here. Went to this bluegrass bourbon thing last night. Didn't drink any bourbon. Didn't drink anything. Had a good burger. Played some darts. It was a good time. Went to Louisville Slugger Museum. I said, that's a neat place. Got to see where they make all the bats for the MLB players.
Well, all the Alabama fans are going to need something to do tomorrow because we're definitely winning and we're going to stay for Sunday. So what's the top thing you would recommend everybody to do in town tomorrow?
Go check out Louisville Slugger Museum, man. That place is cool.
You got yourself a bat?
Yeah, I got a little mini one. They give you the opportunity to hold game-used bats from some of these icons, these legends. Like, they have a Babe Ruth bat you can sit there and hold and take a picture with. I took a picture with a Hank Aaron bat last night. It was pretty neat.
That's a good decision.
Could you feel his spirit in the bat?
I did. I felt like I was fixing to just knock it out, dude. I felt the spirit of Mobile, Alabama, going through me.
Well, are you pumped for the game tonight, Brady? How's the Million Dollar Band feeling about the ball game? Y'all going to bring the heat tonight and get us into the Elite Eight?
We're going to crunk, man. We're going to bring it. We're going to crank. Me and my boy JC Campbell over here are going to crank.
John,
he's been doing coloring books all day.
Joe, I've actually got a question for Brady about the band, if you don't mind me stepping in here.
Oh, yeah, go ahead.
Brady, we saw, and I'm sure you've seen the video at this point. If not, you need to go check it out, of the, who was it? The Fairleigh Dickinson band playing My Own Worst Enemy by Lit, their own version of a bit of a pop-punk anthem going on.
Dude,
there
I love in Nick. Don't hang on Nick. I love Nick.
All right, so why does Basket Case, how can we get Basket Case to bring that same energy to the fans? Like, is it the score? Is it just the juice the band has for the piece itself? Like, what's going on there, man? Because I felt like that just went so much, so hard.
All right, so part of it is the Alabama students, because most of the times we play Basket Case, there's nobody there in the stands for us to play it for.
Okay.
That's my little soapbox on Alabama students coming up and just leaving in the middle of a game. It's a whole different deal, but that actually wasn't the FCU band.
Stay for four, play for four.
You're right. Who'd they borrow their band from? It was Dayton? It was Dayton University?
It was Dayton.
Yeah.
Yeah, because FCU actually doesn't have a band. They don't have a band in any capacity.
That's crazy. I just felt like there was so much energy.
How do you have an athletic department and not have a band? I'm sorry. How do you have an athletic department and not have a band?
Yeah, there's some, like, Gonzaga has a pretty good basketball band. I don't know a lot about them because they don't have football, but...
Well, Gonzaga's bands program is actually well-noted just as a good music program in the country.
See, I'm not a music major, so I don't really know all of that. Sitting here looking at the West Tower trying to find Joe. What floor are you on, Joe?
11. Come find me.
Man, I'm on
Brady, prediction for the game. Prediction for the game tonight. 100 to nothing. 200 to 10. What do you think?
I think if we hit shot, our pace could be something that hurts San Diego State, but their defense is something that could also hurt us. So I'm leaning towards the skill on Alabama. SDSU has a lot of veteran leadership, but Alabama has so much freaking talent, man. I mean, we have leadership too, JQ. I think we get a good showing from JQ. Brandon has a pretty decent game. There's going to be some random other guy that goes off. It could be Namari, could be Mark Sears, could be whoever. But I think we're going to be all right. I got Bama by 10. Give me
Bama by 10.
Somewhat low score there. We pull away late.
Brady, I'll see you in the building tonight, man. I hope you have a good time.
Yes, sir. I'll see you. Hopefully we can go out and party tonight, Joe.
There you go. Yes, sir. Roll Tide. That's Brady on the Derry Daniels State Farm Hotline. All right, so Brady brings up a good point. We all know, Mark, we all know that Brandon Miller is going to probably have a good game. So who's the one ancillary, and here's the names you cannot pick. You cannot pick JQ. You cannot pick Mark Sears as the next options. He said there's probably going to be somebody that you don't expect to step up. All right, so Brandon Miller not eligible. JQ and Mark Sears not eligible. So we're going around the room. Who are we starting with? Started with Seth Hopper. We're starting with you. Who is the Alabama player that's going to step up, not named Brandon Miller, Mark Sears, or Javon Quinterly?
Well, the only other logical answer is Bediako. I think if Bediako has a good game in the paint, able to defend some shots in the paint and get some shots up, I think if he goes off tonight, I think that would really help us win this game. So my pick is Bediako to step up.
Aiden Dollins.
Dog, Rylan Griffin's got the Lilo and Stitch jammies on in the locker room right now. Rylan Griffin threes rain down tonight in Louisville.
That was going to be my pick. That was going to be my pick too. But I love it. I love it. Rylan is a great pick. Rylan's a great pick. What you say, Seb Shirey? What do you say?
Rylan is a great pick, but I'm going to stick with the guard. But I'm going to go Namari Burnett. I think Namari Burnett is going to be big. He's always big defensively. Obviously, San Diego State might not be the most potent offense in the world, but if we can limit their chances to score, I think plain and simple, with how good our defense is, we outscore them. Namari can also chip in a few threes. I think this is going to be a guard game. I mean, not to take your thunder, Seth, but I think Bediako, while he's going to be valuable, all right, I think this is going to be a game for the fast and small guys trying to keep up with San Diego State.
I'm with you, Sep. I think that my pick will be Noah Clowney Nation. If he goes 3-for-5 from the three-point line, if he goes 2-for-4 from the three-point line, then I think that Alabama's going to really feel good about themselves and come away with a comfortable win. I think Brady's got a good point that it will be somebody will step up. I mean, somebody always does. It's so deep on this team. When we had Chris Stewart on earlier in the day on Inside the Locker Room, he predicted a very tight first half and for Alabama to pull away in the second half. And I think that's what we're going to see. I think it's going to be very similar to the Maryland matchup, where the first half you're kind of thinking to yourself, "Oh my gosh, are we even playing that good? How, you know, what are we going to do in the second half?" But I think the second half you're going to pull away. I'm feeling. I'm still kind of deciding on the final score, but I do think about a 7-point win for the Tide. But it's going to be good for us to be tested. It's going to be good for us to be pushed, because Creighton or Princeton in the next round, by the time you play in that next round, you're only playing fearless opponents. You're only playing opponents who have deep self-belief. So I think it's going to be important for Alabama to play well tonight, play well defensively, and really battle through some adversity. We've only got a couple minutes left in the program today, right here, and so we've talked about Lamar Jackson a lot throughout the offseason. You guys know that I'm a fan of Lamar getting his money, and I hope that the Ravens come to their senses. But it's come a little news tidbit hits the news waves yesterday that some random man, I think Sep Shirey is probably really up on this story because they're Baltimore guys. Some random fella's been negotiating on behalf of Lamar Jackson, and Lamar says, "I don't know this guy. Don't negotiate." The NFL puts out a notice that that you cannot negotiate with this unlicensed non-agent.
Wait, so Lamar Jackson doesn't know who this guy is either? This isn't Lamar further trying to buck the negotiation system?
That's what it sounds like. Lamar has, I believe I saw earlier today, Lamar was like, "Who is this?"
Okay.
Like, don't answer these calls.
His name is Ken Francis.
The ultimate grifter. "Hey man, will you pay me? I'm negotiating on behalf of Lamar Jackson. Will you pay me 15? You know, he tries to take a finder's fee and he doesn't even know Lamar Jackson.
I swear, me and Lamar are friends. I promise you, we are. I'm here to represent him.
He wants to play for you guys. He wants to play for you guys. All you gotta do, $100 million guaranteed, and
half of that's going to me.
You know." Oh my gosh. So do you think will Lamar get this straightened out before the start of the season?
I think so. I think either Baltimore will come to their senses and get him, or there is some team that is willing to pay that amount of money to have a talent like Lamar Jackson. I think he's that good enough to really change a team once they sign him. So I think this will be resolved before the season starts.
Sep Shirey, will we see Lamar Jackson in a Baltimore Ravens uniform?
I think we will. I mean, I think at this point it's inevitable. Like Seth said, yes, there's definitely teams out there that are going to be willing to pay him. But I think Harbaugh wants him. I think the Ravens want him, and I think it's going to happen.
I don't think so, Joe. I heard my buddies at Hooper's Crab House over there saying that Hooper's Crab House in Ocean City, a fine establishment to get your all you can eat crabs during the season. I heard them saying he's already called the manager and is trying to work out a deal to have the crabs mailed to him live and fresh to Nashville, Tennessee.
Oh, come
Nashville.
On.
Nashville.
Titans fans, please stop going with that rumor. It's not happening. We all know Ryan Tannehill will be our starter. We're not getting Lamar.
No,
we don't have the money.
You shouldn't want that. You should be stoked that I just dropped that
bomb. Are trying to build a new stadium.
Seth
we do
Hopper
not have
wants,
that kind of money. So it's not happening. I'm not getting into the false hope that
Seth
we're getting
Seth Hopper
Lamar.
Wants Josh Dobbs. Remember
no,
that
No, we already released
ago.
Him,
he
Joe. That's
Josh
not,
Dobbs.
That's not happening. He's already
like,
with the Browns.
I'm a Taylor Heineke enthusiast, but even I wouldn't want Josh Dobbs.
Okay.
How can you look at your roster as a Titans fan and say, no, we don't want Lamar Jackson?
Because we don't have the money for it, Joe. We're trying to build a new stadium, and we're already paying Ryan Tannehill a lot of money.
What kind of poverty franchise are you running that you can't build a stadium and have a quarterback?
At least our owner is not Dan Snyder. So, but
it's not a high bar.
But we're not getting Lamar, so all the Titans fans, stop believing in that rumor. It's not happening. Ryan Tannehill will be our starter. Then by midseason, when we lost every game that he started, Malik Willis will come in. Then we're going to lose every game when he starts. So.
That way y'all can go draft Caleb Williams next year. That's going to do it for us on Cup of Joe. Big thanks to Derry Daniels, sponsoring the program. Big thanks to the Lynx, and big thanks to you for hanging out and listening to us. We've got Big Noon Sports coming up next. Ryan Fowler on the game at 2 o'clock, and I'll be back with you at 3:30 for Tide Hoops pregame show. For Aiden, Seth, and Sep, thanks so much for hanging out with us. Have a great day and roll Tide. Well, I hear you whispering words, melt everyone, but you stay so cool.